Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. I know what you're all thinking. Middle-aged novelist tries to juice up talk by playing iconic 60s rock music. Not fair. This actually is the first bit of music that I was involved with in a vaguely professional capacity. It's Badge by Cream, a song I listened to endlessly during my school days. When I wrote my first film, Good and Bad at Games, for the then embryonic Channel 4, I insisted that this was the soundtrack. And in fact, it's the only soundtrack that existed on the film, because we had no money. So we played it about six times. However, when we approached the management of Cream, asking if we could use their song on the film, Good and Bad at Games, they said, of course you can, that'll be £30,000, thank you. Well, that was probably the budget of the film. So we had a terrible dilemma on our hands, but we solved it by finding a band down in Brighton, I think, who said they could do a very good Cream replica number. And they did record Badge, and we did use it six or seven times during the film. And people congratulated me on how I'd managed to get this Cream song on this very low-budget film about boarding school life. But that's a bit of a digression, because, in fact, this evening is sort of about music, and so the Cream song is a perfect introduction. This novel that I've written, my first novel, not my first novel, my 15th novel, I think it's my first novel sometimes, but my 15th novel has as its background the world of classical music. The time is late 19th century. I happen to love classical music from that era, which is why I set the novel then. But there's a problem when you write about music in a novel. It's very hard. What can you say? The second movement was sublime. Doesn't really work. Doesn't really catch fire. So you need a kind of portal into that world, it seemed to me. I was thinking about making my central character a musician, perhaps a minor member of an orchestra or something like that. But eventually I was sitting in a club and I saw a man tuning a grand piano, and I suddenly thought, for some reason, why doesn't my guy be a piano tuner? I thought, brilliant idea, except I had no idea about piano tuning at all. I'd never met one, I had no idea what they did. And so I had to find one. And through a series of connections with friends, I did find a brilliant piano tuner, the Royal Academy of Music, a wonderful man called Clive Ackroyd. And Clive, I think, was so stunned that anybody wanted to write a novel about piano tuner that he told me all his secrets, well, almost all his secrets, and allowed me to pick his brains mercilessly. And so my central character became a piano tuner, and this gave me access into the world of classical music, which, like every other world of the arts, is dominated by ego and money. But I think I'll give you a little flavor of the novel. First of all, I'm going to give you some short readings tonight in between my rambling reminiscences. And just to set the tone of the novel and give you a sense of who its central character is, Brodie Moncur, young Scottish lad making his way in the world. And the novel starts in Edinburgh in 1894, and Brodie is working in a showroom of a piano manufacturer's called Channon and Company. So here we go, Edinburgh, 1894. Brodie Moncur stood in the main window of Channon and Company and looked out at the hurrying pedestrians, the cabs, carriages, and laboring drays of George Street. It was raining, a steady, soft rain driven slant from time to time by the occasional fierce gust of wind. And under the ponderous pewter light, the sooty facades of the buildings opposite had darkened with the water to a near black. Like velvet, Brodie thought, or moleskin. He took off his spectacles and wiped the lenses clean on his handkerchief. Looking out of the window again, spectacle-less, he saw that rainy Edinburgh had now gone utterly aqueous. The buildings opposite were a cliff of black suede. He replaced his spectacles, hooking the wire sides behind his ears,
and the world returned to normal. He slipped his watch from his waistcoat pocket. Nearly 9 o'clock, better start. He opened up the glossy new grand piano that was on the display dais, propping up the curved lid with its inlaid mirror, only for display purposes, his idea. Better to present the intricate machinery, the action inside a Channon grand. He removed the fall from over the keys and undid the key block screws. He checked that no hammers were up and then drew the whole action forward by the flange rail under the front. As it was a new piano, it drew out perfectly. Already a passerby had stopped and was peering in. Drawing out the action always compelled attention. Everyone had seen a grand piano with a lid up, but having the action on display somehow altered every easy assumption. The piano no longer seemed familiar. Now all the moving parts were visible beyond the black and white keys, the hammers, the rockers, the jacks, the whippens, the dampers. Its innards were exposed like a clock with its back off, or a railway engine dismantled in a repair shed. Mysteries, music, time, movement, were reduced to complex, elaborate mechanisms. People tended to be fascinated. So that's Brodie. That's him and his work. And the elaborate construction, the elaborate artifice of the novel began with a very simple idea I had, or a phenomenon I'd observed. I loved music. I listened to music all the time, of all types. And I began to notice over the years a strange effect that certain passages of music had on me. Well, we all know how music can move us. And usually it's because of some association with our lives. That song was playing in the pub when you met the one, or that song was playing in the pub when you broke up with the one. And so your musical memories and your personal life intermingle, and that piece of music becomes personal. But I was noticing an effect that for pieces of music that had no autobiographical link with my life began to make my tear ducts tingle. I began to sort of well up. I could be peeling the potatoes or completing my VAT return. And this piece of music would play, and I'd sort of feel all emotional all of a sudden. And I began to write down the pieces of music where this occurred. And it was in all sorts of music. It was classical music, obviously, rock music, show tunes, bluegrass. It was a very, very similar phenomenon. And so I began to wonder if there was some musicological explanation for this, if indeed some combination of notes, some sequence of chords, could, almost as a physical cause and effect, provoke this tingling of the tear duct, this sort of urge to not blub or sob or collapse, but just sort of maybe gently weep. And so this is how the idea of the novel came to me. I thought, what if you wrote a piece of music like that that did make people cry, and then somebody stole it? And this is often how simply novels begin. Something you can sum up in one sentence sets off a kind of chain reaction of questions and answers. Like, who is the person who wrote this music? Who stole it? What time period are we in? What type of music is it? And as you get the answers to these questions, slowly a kind of aggregate of information begins to build up about this novel you're writing. And slowly but surely, it begins to take shape. Anyway, as I was doing my personal Q&A, it takes me a long time, sometimes 2 years before I finally start writing. Very busy, even though it doesn't look like I am. I began to ask friends if they had ever experienced the same phenomenon. And sure enough, they had. And they would send me in lists of songs or lists of passages of music, a chorale or a pop song or something like that. And I duly listened to them and would say, doesn't work on me. And so I think it's something very personal. I think there's something hardwired in you that responds to this sequence of notes that makes you want to cry. So I compiled my lists, and I thought, God, I've got to have some professional help here, because I love music, but I'm not a musician. I learned to play the piano very badly, and the day I told my piano teacher I was giving up the lessons, she practically, you know, jumped for joy and ran around the room. So I thought I must talk to someone who knows what they're talking about. And so I went to talk to a friend of mine, a wonderful composer of largely of film music, called Patrick Doyle. He's one of the top five film composers in the world. And his son, Patrick Neil Doyle, is also a composer. And I've worked with both of them, on one on a film and one on a play. So they were quite happy to be bothered by me. And so I went down to Patrick's studio in Pinewood, armed with seven pieces of music that all had this effect on me. And they were an odd bunch. I had a Brahms horn trio. I had three pieces of Rachmaninoff, all from piano concertos. I had a song by a Scottish band, rock band, called the Blue Nile. I had a piece of Stephen Sondheim from his show Sunday in the Park with George. And I had a bluegrass song sung by Alison Krauss, I don't know if you know, ethereal, beautiful voice. And based on a poem by Robert Louis Stevenson, in fact, sort of haunting kind of folk song. And so I took these seven songs down to Patrick's studio, and I said, what is going on here? Can you explain it to me? Is there something that you musicians see that us mere music lovers, us music listeners, can't make out? And so Patrick Senior and Patrick Junior went to work on their respective pianos and played the bits of music and listened and talked to each other in a language I could not understand, but I was sitting there jotting down their remarks and so on. And they came up with a theory that something similar was going on in all these pieces of music. And so I asked some questions, wrote it all down, and I put it in the novel. So I'm going to read you what they said was happening in these pieces of music and see if it makes any sense to you. But it's, I think it holds water, funnily enough. I think it sort of makes a kind of sense. Anyway, this is later on in the novel, and Brody is in Paris now, and he's tuning a piano. And like many piano tuners, when the piano is ready, they will play a song or a piece of music just to test the whole elaborate machinery. It took Brody another 2 hours after lunch to finish the tuning. He slid the action back into the piano and played his usual Scottish folk song several times in different keys, listening hard for the hammer strikes and the dampers working properly. He felt a hand come to rest softly on his shoulder and turned to find Lika standing there, a tear running down one cheek, wordless. Brody jumped to his feet. Lika, my God, is everything all right? That music, she said, that tune, she added wonderingly. What is it? I heard it. I was standing in the doorway listening, and it made me cry. Look. She wiped away her tears, smiling. How strange. It was like an instinct, a reflex. I heard you playing, and the next thing I knew, my eyes were full of tears. Brody explained, it's a folk song from Scotland. My mother used to sing it to me when I was young. I've changed it a bit, but I use it when I'm tuning, at the end, you know, just to see if everything is fine, if the piano is ready. It's beautiful. Play it again, will you? Of course, he said. Brody sat down and played the song through, all 2 minutes of it. What's it called? It's called My Bonnie Boy. He said the title in English and translated it, Mon Beau Garçon. There are words to the song, just three verses. It's most extraordinary. There's one bit of it, one transition. Is it a key change that makes me want to cry instantly? How can that happen? Then they heard the front door open and Kilbaron appeared, having handed his hat and his coat to a manservant. Kilbaron is a piano virtuoso. Well, hello, hello, he said. All done, Master Brody? He looked at Lika. Are you well, my sweet? Lika, in some excitement, explained about the effect Brody's folk song had had on her. a completely new, unheard piece of music that seemed to provoke a direct attack on her tear ducts. "Good Lord above," Kilbarron said. "What miraculous music is that?" Brodie recounted the story once more. Kilbarron was intrigued and asked him to play it again. So Brodie sat down at the piano and ran through the song once more. Kilbarron listening intently. "See, there," Lika exclaimed, "that moment, those few bars, don't you feel it? So much emotion." "I do, in a way," Kilbarron said, and asked Brodie to play it again. "Yes," he said when Brodie had finished. "It's very simple but effective, an interrupted cadence on a rising scale, accented passing notes. Play it again, if you will, Brodie." Brodie did so. "You expect the tonic, you see," Kilbarron said. "Every instinct is telling you which way the music will go, but it's unresolved, and that's where the emotion springs from." He smiled, an old trick, but old tricks are the best. He budged Brodie away from the piano and sat down at the stool and played the song himself. "See," he said to Lika, "rising sevenths, falling fourths, suspensions, passing notes. There, a falling sixth, a rising ninth." He took his hands off the keys. G flat major to D flat major, then, this is what you don't expect, D flat minor ninth, the unexpected chord. He played the three chords and seemed untypically thoughtful suddenly. "An old folk song, you say," Kilbarron stood and moved away from the piano. "As much an act of memory," Brodie said. "I fiddle around with it over the years. I suppose I've invented half of it." Kilbarron stood by the fireplace, frowning. "Still, very effective, nice little melody also. That's important. Then you can fiddle around with it, as you say." He opened a silver box and took out a cigarillo and lit it. "Do you know who wrote it?" "Traditional," Brodie said. "Nobody knows. Somebody wrote words to the old tune and it entered the folk song repertoire. I remember the tune, and so I took it and made something of it." Well, I think you know who stole the song. Huh? But anyway, that's the theory that the Doyles came up with. And I think it's kind of valid. The unexpected chord, you expect the tonic, you see. Every instinct is telling you which way the music will go, but it's unresolved, and that's where the emotion springs from. Now, okay, and this is the difficult bit. I'm going to try and prove this to you. It works for me. I'm going to play you 50 seconds of Rachmaninoff's second, well, I'm not going to play you, it's going to be played, Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto, where I think there's exactly this effect occurs. So if we could cue the Rachmaninoff. Goosebumps? Oh, yeah. It's that bit in the middle where, again, you hear the rising, the left-hand side of the piano rising, that I think, and I play it again and again, and it has the same effect. So I wonder. Anyway, that was my theory, and I put it in the novel, and I have professional musicians to blame if I'm challenged. But it's, in a way, it's symptomatic also of my working practice, I suppose. I have a little credo here, which I'll read you out. I'm a realistic novelist. I say it unashamedly. If I was a painter, I would be a figurative painter. And I think, as a realistic novelist, you have a duty to your readers. And I pinched this from a Serbian writer, actually, now dead, called Danilo Kiš. And Danilo Kiš, I sort of adapted it a bit for my own working practice. And this is what he says and what I say, that the key factor in fiction is to make your readers believe in the truth of your story. They must believe that what they are reading actually happened. Any means to this end is acceptable, as long as it works. So that's what I try to do in my fiction. I now realize, having written 15 novels, that I try to make the world of the novel as absolutely real as possible and the characters in it as real as possible. So there's a kind of suspension of disbelief on the reader's part. The reader knows that he or she is reading a work of fiction, but somehow that seduction has to be as complete as possible so that it seems as if the world of the novel is a real world and the people in it are real and what they're going through is real. I think it was in my second novel that I really started to put this belief, or this manifesto, into practice. My second novel was called An Ice Cream War, and it's set in East Africa during the First World War. There was a British colony called British East Africa, now Kenya, and there was a German colony called, with great originality, German East Africa, now Tanzania. And when World War I broke out, the two colonies went to war as well. It was an extraordinary part of the conflict and sort of forgotten. It's been written up more recently, but when I, back in 1981, 82, when I was writing the novel, there was very little written about this conflict. And it wasn't a war of trenches. There was a German army that was pursued by a British colonial army through the bush of East Africa. Germans were never defeated. They were always on the run. By the time 1918 came around and the armistice arrived on November the 11th, they wanted the two armies in East Africa to stop fighting, but they couldn't find them. They were actually somewhere in Rhodesia. And eventually, 2 weeks after the armistice in Europe, they found the haggard British colonial army, the even more haggard German troops in the bush in Rhodesia, and said that you can stop now, it's all over. Anyway, what I did in the case of this novel is I took exactly that campaign, the battles in the novel, the situation of the novel is entirely realistic. It's almost like a history book. And into that world, I put my fictional characters. And I see now, looking back, that in a way, this is what I've done ever since, that I've taken real events, I've often used real people, and put them into a fiction, or put a fiction into that reality, and tried to live up to that little credo I read out to, any means to this end is acceptable as long as it works. And it did work in An Ice Cream War. The book was very successful for me, and most amazingly, as a young writer, I was in my early 30s, I had an enormous success in France with it. Out of the blue, there was a program on French television called Apostrophe, presented by a man called Bernard Pivot. And it was on Friday night, 9 o'clock to 11 o'clock, live, audiences of 9 million people, only in France, listening to writers talk. And Bernard Pivot is an extraordinary man. He read every word of the novels that were on. He had copious notes. He was incorruptible. You couldn't get on Apostrophe if you paid him a king's ransom if he didn't like you or your book. And so when my French publisher said, "You've been chosen to go on Apostrophe," there's no way I could have said, "I'm busy." But it was live and in French, you know. Squeaky bum time, as Alex Ferguson would say. Anyway, I did it, and I went on the plateau, and I stumbled through my interview with Bernard Pivot, and the other guests were there. And maybe it was because I seemed nervous, but Pivot went a bit mad. And he obviously loved the novel. He, at one stage in the program, he held it up, brandished it to the camera, and said, if anybody, in French obviously, if anybody doesn't like this novel, I will personally reimburse them the cost of it. And I've heard my publisher fall off her chair. And sure enough, it became a news event. I signed books the next day at the Paris Book Fair for 11 hours. And the book became a triumphant success in Paris. It was sold 20,000 copies, 30,000 copies, on and on, over 100,000 copies. You know, it was astonishing. This is where it all turns very sad. I'm going to lead you into the dark underbelly of the novelist's life. So I'd had this phenomenal success. And, you know, foreign publishers are lucky. They don't have to pay royalties for at least a year and a half. But, of course, you know, I wasn't stupid. I knew 100,000. I got such a tiny advance for the book. I'd hit pay dirt. You know, I'd won the lottery, and I was calculating, as one does, you know, what my check might amount to. And my wife, Susan, and I were already spending this money, which we hadn't yet got, but, you know, it's only a matter of time. So the due date came around for the payment of my French windfall. It wasn't there. Rang my agent, said, where's the French money? We need it, we've spent it. She said, well, let me chase them up. I remember that day vividly, my blood runs cold even now. Phone rang in our little house in Fulham, and my agent was on the other line. She said, hello, Will. Bad news, I'm afraid. turned out that my publisher, who was a man called André Ballon, his publishing company was called Edition André Ballon, was pretty much bankrupt. And this gusher of money that he'd had from my novel, which was called Comme Neige au Soleil in French, was propping up his, you know, seriously damaged company. It didn't help that Ballon, it turned out, was also an avid gambler and would go up to Deauville and Trouville of a weekend with his sixth or seventh wife and gamble away my money as well. So something great happened, something absolutely appalling happened. I experienced a form of pure rage, which I haven't really experienced since. It seemed so unfair. You know, it's just, you know, you sell 100,000 copies, you know, he'd taken his profit, for God's sake. He only had to pay me 10%, but he spent it all. So I thought, well, what the hell do I do now? Do I just shrug my shoulders and, you know, chalk it up to experience? But no, my translator is a wonderful woman who became and is a very good friend. Said, well, you have to sue him, of course. So I, first of all, I wrote to Ballon. He said, well, you have to sue me, of course, because the bank owns this company, and if you don't register your claim, you might get nothing. So again, through the good offices of my translator, I hired a French lawyer, a wonderful French lawyer, called Anne Vey, and she said, you know, French justice is implacable, but it's very, very slow moving. We will win, but it will take a long time. So I said, okay, I'm up for it. That will be £5,000, please. French lawyers don't even open a file unless you pay some money up front. So I started this process of litigation against André Ballon. I think it's time to have a look at him. Right, here we are, 1985, this is when this all happened. This is a gathering of French novelists and their publishers in the Brasserie Lip on the Boulevard Saint-Germain. And if you just see this man in a very, very extreme, shifty-looking figure there. That is André Ballon himself. That is me, that young chap with a tie on and all that hair. This is the only photograph I have of me and him together. But I think it's quite interesting that he's so far away from me. Now I look at it, you know, he didn't want to be in this picture. Because after this very jolly lunch, the guy at the front, this guy here is called Jan, he just won the Prix Goncourt, so he was very happy. So it was a gathering, it was a sign of how successful the novel had been, that that I was, a British writer, was invited to this, you know, rather grand lunch in the Brasserie Lip. And I walked back down the Boulevard Saint-Germain with André Ballon, chatting about my next book, and I thought, this is the literary life, isn't it? You know, lunch in the Brasserie Lip, you know, fellow writers, a genial publisher talking about my next book, and then the bastard went and stole all my money. So what happened next was this process of litigation began. I sued him. He'd actually stolen about £80,000 from me. Well, that's a lot of money today, let alone 1985. All those royalties were owing to me, and he couldn't pay me. So I sued, and he had to put money in escrow accounts, and so on. The process began. And then it turned out that he sold his company to another company called Copagest. I said, what the hell's Copagest? And it turned out it was a French taxi company. So I had to sue Copagest as well. And they stole money from me. They stole my book club rights and my paperback rights. So actually the sum of money was now approaching £100,000 that I didn't have. And so we went to the first case, and as Anne Vail said, French justice is implacable but very slow. She said, we've won, but they're appealing. And so they appealed, and 2 years later, we had another case which we won and which they appealed against. And so slowly but surely, I was advancing through the ranks of the French justice system to higher and higher courts, winning every case, but having to wait a year or two for the appeal to be heard, to be vindicated again, to win. And finally, we ended up in a court called the Cour de Cassation, the sort of highest court in the land. And I said, what's going on now, Anne? We were in first name terms by this time. And she said, well, this court is the last court they can take you to, and it's to examine the documents that we have put forward to see if there are any errors in them, misplaced comma or a capital letter in the wrong place. So scrupulous examination of the documents to see if there's been some sort of blunder that will allow them to claim that they've been misrepresented and not have to pay the money. And Anne Vail said, but unfortunately, I'm not allowed to plead in the Cour de Cassation. You'll have to get another lawyer. So I did. She called Maître Lempicka, I think his name was. He said, that'll be £3,000. So we sued in the Cour de Cassation. We won. Great day. Victory to the novelist over the evil publisher. But in fact, I ended up with only about half the money he owed me. It was a happy ending eventually, because of course I took my books away from André Ballon and resold them to another French publisher called Le Seuil, who very reputable, who remain my publisher to this day, and who pay scrupulously on time. And all's well that ends well, except it was a kind of bitter experience, and the whole thing took 11 years. But then I did win, and I felt at the end of the day, the victory wasn't so much about recovering whatever funds we could claw back from Ballon. It was more a sense of almost natural justice, that I had been wronged, and the law allowed me to right that wrong and to preserve my integrity, if you like, as a novelist. Final bitter irony was that once Ballon had finally gone bust, and I liked him, after that, he was a genial bloke, but he decided to give up being a publisher and become a novelist. he wrote a couple of detective novels, and he published them with Le Seuil.
my publisher. And I said to my editor, does he ever come to the building? She said, oh, yes, he comes in, Andre, you know, he pops in from time to time. I thought, well, what the hell do I do if I bump into him in the foyer of Le Seuil? You know, do I just go, bonjour, Andre, ça va, you know, or do I nut him or something? But luckily, I never met him, and he's now gone to the great publishing house in the sky, which is why I can traduce him without fear. But it was an example of the downs that can arrive in the writing world, and it sobered me up and made me realise that there's no such thing as a sure thing, certainly not a royalty check. Anyway, that's the story of André Ballon. I think this is probably a good moment to allow you to go to the bar and have a large drink. See you in 20 minutes or so. Thank you.